The ongoing mission of Bethany Baptist Church, SBC, is to provide an accurate picture of the one true and living God to our members and to the community. We will accomplish this continually through worship, fellowship, discipleship, ministry, and evangelism. Here at Bethany, we love God. We acknowledge the kingdom of God. The kingdom is revealed to man through Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Join us in worship, prayer, and His living word.
Let me say good morning and welcome to all our Bethanites and to all those that are viewing live stream. We thank God for you. We come now to worship God. We come to give Him all His praise. We come to give Him all His honor. We come to praise and we come to worship Him. But there is a difference between praise and worship. Praise is thanking God for what He has done. But worship is thanking God for who He is. So we come now for praise and worship. We come to magnify the Lord. We come to lift up the name of Jesus. We welcome the Holy Spirit into the church and into your home. These and all things we ask in Jesus' name. And all of God's children said amen, amen, and amen. Let's have church.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above. We thank the Lord for this opportunity to invite your home into the church via live stream. Today we have a baby dedication, and this has never been more urgent. One of the things that our news shows us is that our children are most vulnerable now more than ever before. In this 21st century, it seems that sin has taken a stronghold and it is consuming our young people. One of the things that the church has as a part of the training is this ceremony that's called Godparenthood. And one of the roles of being a godparent is to ensure that not only in the home, but also those that are surrounding the family, they keep the child under the authority of Almighty God, make sure that church and the life and fellowship and the blood of Christ remains in that child's life until such time that that child has an opportunity to make a decision for Christ on his own. Today, we have Zaire Jael Moore. And the last time I saw this little fella, he was running around here, but he looks so sweet today. Every parent will understand exactly what I'm talking about. Listen, one of the things that's vitally important, I have Brianna and I have Corey. You guys, it's important. Zaire didn't ask to come. into this world. But now you guys have a responsibility. It's really no longer about you two. That's why his name is the biggest thing on this piece of paper. It's really important. The other day we heard that there was a mass shooting. That's not uncommon in this day in which we live. People are going into schools, and let me make it real clear. Our children are vulnerable, and they are dying. Satan is not playing with us. God is serious. When we study his word, it's not something that we take for granted. Vitally important. And so, with all of the names, why don't you put up names and godparents once again so that we can see. This is Lil Zaire, Brianna Barrett, Corey Moore. You serve as the parents. God has invested in you, and now it's time for you to invest in him. Do you accept the responsibility for raising your child under the authority of Almighty God, his word, his church? Do you accept this responsibility so that God's presence will always be in his life? Do you accept this vow? Okay. You, out of all the people in the world, you've chosen two godmothers and a godfather to represent the authority of God in the life, in your life, and in the life of Zaire. Godmother, Dr. Constance Renee Jordan. And Dr. Jordan, I have here that you are a member of Word of Flame Church in Little Rock, Arkansas, under the authority of God's man, Frank A. Jordan. We thank the Lord for you and for your faithfulness in the kingdom. It's a great choice. Sister Vicki McCants, we thank the Lord for you, member of New Fishers Church. We thank the Lord that under his authority, you continue to allow the Lord to be a part of the life that you live. We simply ask now that you transfer this responsibility, the same faith that you have under God's authority in his church, that you make sure that that is present in the life of little Zaire. Steve Hall Jr., son of my loins, they chose you to be a godfather. This is an awesome responsibility, to be sure. I don't know what I'd do if I lost some of my children to Satan. I really don't. And so it is a great responsibility of godfather to be representative of the presence of God in the life of this child. Do you accept this responsibility that we have? For all of the family and friends who are here, I want to again remind people that this is not a game. The world has taken this as a little game, something you can take or leave, when this is serious. People are dying. And we are truly losing little ones like this. In 10 years, he'll be at a point where he starts to make his own look arounds and make his life a part of this world that he's in. 10 years more, it's very possible that he'll be married and have a family of his own. What I'm trying to tell you is that we don't have time to fool around. And so let us hear the word of the Lord as we lift little Zaire Jael Moore before the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart, and ye shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. The steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting upon those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. And he took a child and put him in the midst of them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me." May God add a blessing to the reading and to the hearers of his word.
This is so serious that in our church here at Bethany, two deacons are assigned to every family. They are assigned to every family for the purpose of being close and intimate and making sure that every need is met. Today, with the letter of M for more, we have assigned Deacon Miles, and we have our chairman, Deacon Howard. They are here. They are standing with you today, Deacon Miles, Deacon Howard, because this is serious to us. And what we want is we want Zaire to be blessed of the Lord. And I ask our deacons and our ministers to come closer. And I ask you to maintain your distance, and then we'll allow you to have the baby as a part of it in just a moment. Let us hear our plea to the Lord. Merciful Savior, we thank you on this day. We lift before you Zaire Jael Moore. We thank you, Master, for his life. We pray now in the name of Jesus that you will look and have mercy. We ask your blessings on Corey. We ask your blessings on Brianna. We pray, dear Lord, that you will lift them from one victory to the next, and that they might know in their hearts that there is a responsibility and that you hold them accountable for. Thank you for people like Renee and Vicky. Thank you for people like Steve Jr. That will be an example as Zaire lives his little life. He will look at them and know that there is a remnant in the land in which we live that honors Almighty God. Now bless him, and we'll give your name the praise for it all. But it's in Jesus Christ we ask these things. In Jesus' name we pray. God's people said, amen. He is dedicated. May congratulate him. Amen. I'm going to give you. That is here. Instructions are in there. It'll be obvious. Okay. Love you.
Everybody, he's worthy to be praised. Here we go. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Everybody say it.
Praise the Lord with me. Praise the Lord with me. Praise the Lord with me.
Oh, come on and praise the Lord with me. Come on and say it. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord with me. Praise the Lord with me. Praise the Lord with me.
Say hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Come on and dance before the Lord. Everybody dance.
Dance before the Lord.
Dance before the Lord.
Before the Lord. Dance before the Lord.
Well, come on and dance before the Lord. Dance before the Lord.
Dance before the Lord. Dance before the Lord. dance before the Lord.
Say hallelujah,
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 oh,
hallelujah.
Say hallelujah,
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 oh. Savior up, everybody lift the Savior,
the Savior up,
lift the Savior up,
the Savior up,
oh,
lift the Savior up,
well, come on and lift the Savior up, everybody lift him up,
the Savior up,
lift the Savior up,
the Savior up,
oh, lift
the Savior up.
Say hallelujah,
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 hallelujah.
Say hallelujah,
hallelujah,
oh, 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 oh,
hallelujah.
Say hallelujah,
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 hallelujah.
Say hallelujah,
hallelujah,
oh,
hallelujah.
What a mighty God we serve. Lord God, we are living in some terrible times. Lord God, we are living in some evil times, and Lord God, if we are to continue, Lord God, we're going to have to go back, Lord God, we're going to have to go back to our first love, and we're going to have to learn to call on you right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, I pray and I ask right now that you would just have your way. Pray, Lord God, for those that have lost loved ones. Lord God, we pray for those that are sick and, Lord God, seem to not be able to get well. Lord God, I pray for those that are unemployed and are seeking employment this morning. I pray right now in the name of Jesus that you will be a bridge over troubled waters, that you will be water in dry places. Have your way, Lord God. Lord God, some single parent, some single mother this morning, Lord God, she doesn't know where the next meal is going to come from. She doesn't know where the next dollar is going to come from. Lord God, I ask and I pray right now in the name of Jesus. Pray that you will step into that situation. Pray that you will step into that circumstance. And I pray that you will be a way out of no way. Lord God, just have your way right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, we want to pray for this city. We want to pray for this state. We want to pray for this country. We pray for this world right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, we pray for those who profess to be leaders. And Lord God, we pray that you would touch their hearts and touch their minds right now in the name of Jesus. Pray for every church that's open in your name, every church that's under sound doctrine right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, we pray for our children. As it has already been said, our children are in trouble, Lord God. And so I ask and I pray right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, have your way. And Lord God, I pray that you will bless our children right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, I pray for Bethany Baptist Church here on Homestead Road. I pray, Lord God, for our church as a whole. And I pray for every auxiliary, Lord God. I pray for every missionary. I pray for every leader. I pray for every deacon, every minister. Lord God, I pray for every member right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, it's April 2021, and Lord God, many have gone on, and so I ask and I pray right now that you will bless those that are grieving this morning. Lord God, let them know that their hope is not in this world, but their hope should be in you right now in the name of Jesus. We pray for our pastor.
pray, Lord God, that you will bless him from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet right now in the name of Jesus. We pray for our assistant pastor, Reverend Hunter. I pray that your blessings going out and is coming in. Bless their families and their family tree. Lord God, we pray for the services today. Pray for those that are tuned in. I pray, Lord God, that your word would go out, and we know that if it goes out, it will not come back void. I pray that it would do, Lord God, what you will declare that it will do. Pray that you will save sinners right now in the name of Jesus. Reclaim backsliders right now in the name of Jesus. Strengthen those that need to be strengthened right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, now when we go on the last mile of the way, when we lay down our hymn books and put up our Bibles, Lord God, we pray that you will give us a place. Lord God, give us a place somewhere in that kingdom. Lord God, somewhere where we might praise that name forevermore. Lord God, it's these and all blessed. We ask in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. And thank God.
Church, say amen. At this time, we're going to prepare our hearts and our minds for giving. Although you are at home right now, this is the point of the service. You can all participate. We all can play a part in the service right now in our tithes and offering. Bethanyites, you know your responsibilities to the tithes and offering. To our visitors, we have four ways here at Bethany Baptist Church that you can give. Four simple ways. First, we can do it the old-fashioned way. You can come the curbside. The deacons will meet you outside. They'll collect your offering, and they'll even pray with you and pray for you. Then we have a fail-proof system, our mail system. You can mail it to 7304 Homestead, 77028, and our staff will definitely receive it. Then you can do it by auto draft. You can call your bank. You can set up an auto draft that you can either have one payment taken out for that month, or you can have a continual payment taken out each month. You call your bank and set that up, and they'll be happy to do that for you. And then for all of those who are just high tech, we have our mobile app that you can use. You can go to hashtag Bethany1925 on the Cash App, and you can give your tithes and offering right there. And we thank God, whatever way you choose is the right way for you, and we thank God for that. Scripture reading will come from 2 Corinthians 9, commencing at verse 6 and completing at verse 8. It is written in the record of authority and indicated in God's word. But this I say, he who sows sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he who sows bountifully shall also reap bountifully. Every man according to his purpose in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. For this is the word of God for the people of God. Glory be to God. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give back to you for that which belongs to you. Lord, we are just part of the management team. Lord, you are over everything. You own everything. Everything is yours. And we thank you for allowing us to be faithful stewards to your word. Now, Lord, we pray and we thank God for all those who have given their tithes and offering. And then, Lord, we lift those up who may feel that they are unable to give. But, Lord, we thank you for them as well. Now, Lord, continue to grow Bethany Baptist Church as a whole, that these gifts may be an upgoing for the kingdom. Lord, these and all things we ask in Jesus' name. And all of God's children said, amen, amen, and amen.
I look back and see just how good God's been to me. I can't murmur or complain. He kept me through the storm and rain. I can't
thank him enough.
I can't
thank him enough.
I can't
thank him enough.
He's been good. So good.
So good.
I can't
thank him enough.
Children
began to taunt him and tease him and calling him church boy. As he continued to advance in his studies and became well known at the high school, his grades excelled and they continued to call him church boy. He went out for the football team and the basketball team, and he starred in track. He excelled in it all, and they continued to call him church boy. But it did not end the way that it started. They started by taunting him and challenging his salvation, even mocking him. But as he excelled, the nickname church boy stuck. And they began to chant as he would enter the stadium, church boy. You see, it didn't end the way Satan thought it would. And I want you to know that your life shouldn't end the way that Satan wants it to be. There's something to this thing that we call salvation. We live in a world that is crazy at best. It appears that people have lost their minds, but that's been the case for quite some time now. As a matter of fact, that appears to be the case even when we start reading the story of the Garden of Eden. But I want to share with you this morning, and I thank the Lord for your faithfulness, Bethany. Those of you who are watching and those of you who've continued to be faithful over this last year in this pandemic, realizing that our God is still able, I want to talk to you this morning about this very serious matter of salvation. There's a passage of scripture that Paul got real serious about, and he wrote in his letter to the Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 6. There are, let's see, three verses within this chapter that I want to read, and I'll expound upon these verses. But in your own time, I would that you would read this chapter and some of the surrounding context, because it has much to say to us. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning with verse 9, there you'll find these words. He says, "Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulteresses, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God." Look at verse 11. He says, "And such were some of you." He's writing to the church. "And such were some of you, but," somebody say "but." "But you are washed, but you are sanctified, but you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God." I want to speak to you this morning from this subject. We'll not hold you long. I know Zaire is ready to go and party. So I want to talk to you from this subject, what it means to be saved. What it means to be saved. If you got that Bible in your hands, I want you to take that Bible and I want you to hold it high. Even at home, I want you to hold your Bible high. The truth is that very concerned. We've got some preachers that haven't even picked up their Bible since this pandemic broke us up. Amen. And I'm looking for them. Amen. I want you to repeat after me. This is my Bible. It does not merely contain the Word of God. It is the Word of God. And I believe God. I believe God is who He says He is. I believe God can do what He says He can do. I believe that I am who God says that I am, and I believe I can do
What God says I can do, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now you've got to believe that. Can't just be a bumper sticker theology. It's got to be a lifestyle. It's got to be something you're willing to live, even if they call you church boy. You got to be willing to live it. What does it mean? Thank you, all over. What does it mean to be saved? What does it mean? Because salvation is not about you running around with a big Bible under your arms trying to convince folk that you're saved. Yes, sir. Being saved is not running around, jumping around, hollering about I'm saved, filled with the Holy Ghost, and then you live your life like hell. Several decades ago here in Houston, during one of Billy Graham's evangelistic crusades, a man who owned a liquor store got saved. The next morning, that man put a sign on the front door of his business, and it says, I'm out of business. Why? Because he was saved. He was not willing to carry on the same kind of business that he had before he got saved. There was another man who was saved in an evangelistic service in another state. I'm talking about seriously being saved. Folks in the neighborhood knew him as Old John. Talked about nicknames earlier. People pick up nicknames for a lot of different reasons. They called him Old John. Old John was notorious for being the town drunk. And everybody knew he was the town drunk. They called him Old John. Somebody met him on the street the next morning after he was at that crusade and he got saved. And they hollered out to him, good morning, Old John. He said, who are you talking to? My name is not Old John. He said, you can call me New John. He said, I'm new because I've been born again, and Old John wanted his new name to reflect his new birth. What made the difference? Because he was the same man, or he appeared to be. He was still living on the street, or they thought he was. What made the difference? A transformation had taken place in his life. And that transformation makes all the difference in the world. Another man from a small Texas town used to tie his horse in front of the old saloon every morning. Some of these little towns still have saloons at the end of the town, on one end of the town, and on the other end of the town, there's a church. So one morning, the saloon keeper saw the man's horse tied in front of the church instead of in front of the saloon. Man was walking down the street, so the saloon keeper cried out, say, fella, why is your horse hitched in front of that church today? Man turned around and shouted back to him, well, last night I accepted Jesus as my personal savior at that church, and I've changed hitching post. He said, my life is just not the same anymore. Why? Because he was no longer hitched to sin. He was now hitched to a risen savior. Now, these three stories tell us something about what it means to be saved. Brothers and sisters, being saved means to change your way of life. It means that your eternal destination has forever been shifted from this physical, sinful world to a spiritual, heavenly reality. It means being saved has that you've hitched yourself in faith to God so that his plan for your life can be accomplished. Everybody knows what it means to be lost. Everybody. Everybody knows what it means to be lost. As a matter of fact, we are all experts at being lost. There are millions of ways and experiences in how to get lost and be lost and stay lost. But there is only one way to be saved. Today I want to talk about what it means to be saved. Apostle Paul was a Pharisee. He is the author of the scriptures that we read earlier. He was an educated man. He was a man of respectability. He was a well-known man. He was a very scholarly man. Scriptures tell us that Paul could speak 14 languages. Paul was a bad boy. He was a very zealous man about the law. He would debate you about the law, the word of God. Even at a young age, he had attained more than most other men who were much older than he. I'm talking about this man, Saul. He was not just well educated in the law of God, but like every other person he knew, he was a sinner. He had all of these things to his pedigree, but he was a sinner, and he was good at it. Have you read this Bible? He had used his great authority to track down people who identified themselves as disciples of the way. In other words, they were Christians. Paul made himself a one-person avenging angel. But when we run down the rest of Paul's pedigree, we find that Paul met Jesus on his Damascus Road experience. And now he has hitched his life to a Savior and not the Sanhedrin Council. He took on a new name. No longer was his name Saul of Tarsus, but he is now Paul the Apostle. All because he didn't get another degree. He didn't have any more experiences. He had nothing more to put on his resume. What made the difference was that he got saved. In 1 Corinthians, Paul expressed quite well what it means to be saved. And that's these scriptures that I read earlier. And these are the things we're going to look at. We're going to turn them upside down. We're going to share with you, and then I'm going to let you go. Look at verse 9 and 10, because it talks about the sins of unrighteousness. This is some serious stuff. These are the sins against self and against others. And so Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9, he says, "Know ye not," in other words, don't you know, "that the unrighteous shall not," somebody say not, "shall not inherit the kingdom of God." And a lot of people think that they're going anyhow. That's not what the word of God says. People say, "Well, I'm a good person." Nowhere in the Bible does it say only good people go to heaven, because we make our own standards of what good is. He says, "shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind." Look at verse 10. "Nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God." Brothers and sisters, this statement is true about all of us, because look at verse 11. Look at what verse 11 says. "And such were some of you." He names all of this crazy stuff. And then he says, "Oh yeah, you're in the church now, but such were some of you." Such were some of us. You may not be as bad as somebody else, but all of us were on our way to hell with no God on our side. Whether you want to admit it or not, what made such a dramatic difference in Paul's life? It wasn't his education. He already had that. It wasn't his family heritage. He was already a Jew. He already had that. It wasn't his authority and status. He was already a Pharisee. He already had that. It wasn't his political affiliation. He was already an elite in the Sanhedrin Council. He already had that. It wasn't his citizenship. He was already a citizen of the Roman Empire. He already had that. He already had power. He had prestige. He had wealth. He had the right ancestry. He had the favor of the government, but he was not saved. And as a result, he was a detriment to himself and everybody around him. Oh, yeah. And he was on his way to hell with all of that behind his name. But, somebody say but. But. Scriptures say, but he got saved. I said he got saved. That's something that he did not have. I want to give you three things that being saved means. Three things that being saved means. Number one, it means to be saved means to be cleansed from sin. We're going to talk about each of these. We're going to give them all, list them all, and then we'll talk about them, and then we'll be finished. Number two, to be saved means to be set apart. That's what sanctified means, to be set apart. It means to be set apart for service. Number three, it means to be justified by God. We need to find out what that means. Justified, what does that mean? Let's go back. Let's look at number one. Number one, to be saved means to be cleansed from sin. It means to be cleansed from sin. Does that mean perfect? No, that's not what the scripture says. Let's look at what it says. 1 Corinthians 6 and 11. And such were some of you. And then he uses that conjunction. In the English language, that conjunction. But, it says, but you are washed. That word, but, is the strongest kind of advertisement. But is a conjunction. It is a word that is used to show a clinging break between what has gone before the but and what comes after the but. The phrase cleansing from sin means the forgiveness of sins. To be cleansed from sin means the forgiveness of sins. When Christ saves us, he forgives our sins. Look at Ephesians 1 and 7. Ephesians 1 and 7 says this, in whom, talking of Jesus Christ, says, in whom we have redemption through his blood. How do I get saved? Through his blood. The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. In Ephesians 1 and 7, Paul equates forgiveness with redemption. That is very important. Don't run past that. The first step in forgiveness of sin is to realize that we need forgiveness. The greatest hindrance to men accepting salvation seems to be that we don't want to realize that we really need to be saved. I can't tell you how many people I run into that really think that salvation is just for poor people and people who don't have anything, that they don't need salvation, that they don't need anything. You can be rich on your way to hell and think that you're rich beyond compare when you're poor in heavenly things. A man who is drowning and refused to grab a hold of the life raft that was just thrown out to him, then that man is insisting on dying. And that is exactly what many folks have chosen because they are ignorant of needing to be saved. They think that somehow they can worship or satisfy some spiritual hunger based on their own standard, or they don't need a standard at all. Notice that of all those ugly categories of sin that Paul wrote about, he says, and such were some of you. And such were some of you. He wrote about all of these things, adulterers, talking about effeminate, he talked about idolatry. And he says, and such were some of us, talking about in the church. They were those things, but now their sins are forgiven. And I've got some news for you today. Some of us were some of those awful things mentioned in verses 9 and 10. How then do we move from those awful, ugly things into this forgiveness? How does it come about? Well, look at what Revelation 1 and 5 says. Revelation 1 and 5 says this, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness. Look at what it says, talking about Jesus. And he is the first begotten of the dead and the prince of the kings of the earth. It continues, unto him, what did he do? That loved us. So he loved us. Christ loved us. And look at what he did. He washed us from our sins in his own blood. Now, Revelation 1 and 5 refers to Jesus Christ as the one who loved us. Not one of many, but he's the only one. It talks about him as the anointed one. The anointed one means that there's only one. He is the one who loved us and washed away our sins with his own blood. And that is exactly how forgiveness and cleansing from sin comes about. In a book, the author named Herschel Ford, in one of his books called Simple Sermons on Christian Doctrine, he gave a great illustration. Herschel Ford gave this illustration. He told this story about a preacher said to a dying woman, have you made your peace with God? She knew she was dying. He knew she was dying. So he just simply asked, have you made your peace with God? She said, no. He said, do you realize that you are dying and that soon you must go to face God and give an account of your life? The woman said, yes, but I'm not disturbed about any of that. I do not have to make my peace with God. He said, why? She said, because Jesus made that peace for me on Calvary over 2,000 years ago. So now I'm just resting. She said, I'm just resting in that peace that he made for me a long time ago. And she's exactly right. You see, she was saying, there's nothing else I can do. I've accepted Jesus as my Savior. I'm saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Spirit. I've served him to the best of my ability. I'm a member of the body of Christ, and now I'm ready because of the peace that Jesus made mine a long time ago. In other words, she was saying, I'm saved. Christ has already made peace for us, which is the forgiveness and cleansing us from sin. We only need to enter into that peace through faith in him. Salvation is not an arrogance toward Christ, his church, or the fellowship of the saints. Quite the contrary, it is a peace that surpasses all understandings, which make it possible for us to live and die within his reconciliation. To be saved means then to be cleansed from our sins. That's not the only thing it means. Number two, to be saved means to be set apart for his service. Look back at verse 11 again. Verse 11 says, and such were some of you, but you are washed. And then he says, but you are sanctified. Now, there's that conjunction again. He said, but you are sanctified. Sanctified is not just somebody running around the church, jumping up, trying to touch the lights. Being sanctified, when you are saved, our sins are forgiven. But along with forgiveness comes sanctification, which means to be separate or to set apart. When God saved us, he sets us apart for his own use, for his own purpose. We don't have the right to do our own thing, as some people so recklessly claim. The verb tense of this word is the same as the tense for washed. Remember, a verb is an action word in any language. This means that sanctification is a decisive action that God has taken on our behalf at some point, and his action is related to each of us. At the time of our faith and belief in Christ, God not only forgives our sins, but he also sets us apart for his service. When America entered World War II, American automobile plants changed their peacetime production to wartime production. In other words, as long as we were at peace, they were making automobiles. But when we entered into World War II, every automobile factory changed from making cars. Instead, they started making airplanes and tanks and troop carriers. In other words, they were set apart for a new type of work. The entire purpose of their work was now changed. It was the same plant, but they underwent a transformation because they had a new service. And so it is when a person is saved. The entire purpose of his or her life is changed. Brothers and sisters, do you even know that there is a war going on? Have you heard that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places? Excuse me. Sanctification, then, is a definite act of the part of God that the time that person is saved and your life is no longer your own. God has a new service for us. At the time of salvation, the person is set apart for service to God. That's why we can also consider sanctification as the process of growth that every Christian experiences in their life journey. Because from salvation to glorification is a lifelong journey of sanctification and growth and development, and God using us for his service.
Sanctification is not only an act, but also a process. We are to grow in God's grace. We are to be better this year than we were last year. We are to be a better service to the master than we were last year. You cannot be sanctified and continue to do your own thing or serve for your own purpose. It's not sanctification in that way. If you continue to do your own thing, then you are in direct rebellion to God's action to sanctify you, and that, my friend, is called sin. To be saved means to be set apart for his service, but that's not all. There's a third thing that salvation means. To be saved means, and there's that word again, to be justified by God. Look back at 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11 again, because Paul used several things. He said, we're some of you, but you are washed. We talked about that. But you are sanctified. We talked about that. Then he said, but you are justified. You are justified. What does Paul mean when he says that I am justified? You see, justification is just another term that Paul used to communicate our salvation. Justification is a legal term. They use it in the court very often. It's used in a very important way here in the Word of God. Justification basically means to show something that is wrong, to show it as correct or right, on to pronounce something or someone as right, even though it is not. To pronounce them as innocent, even though they may have been considered guilty. But this definition fails to capture all that salvation means, because God does not merely pronounce us as being right or innocent. God actually makes us right and innocent. How does he do that? Because our unrighteousness is replaced by Jesus' righteousness. Jesus exchanged his righteousness for our unrighteousness. And this is why he was able to die in our place. This is what's at the heart of the idea of God justifying a sinner like you and me. This is the very nature of salvation and the reality of being born again in physical birth. You cannot birth yourself. Today we had a baby dedication. We dedicated little Zahir to the Lord. He didn't get here by himself. Yeah, he didn't get in a car and drive his way here. Amen. Some decisions were made for him. But long before that, he was born into this world. He couldn't birth himself. It was on the part of others. And in this new birth, it takes the action of God. You cannot save yourself. In justification or salvation, God does for us what we cannot do for ourselves. That's why I'm on my way to heaven. Not because I'm so good or have kept his commandments so well, but because I'm justified in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord and by the Spirit of Almighty God. Has anybody read this Bible? I want you to notice three things about justification, because that word is so important. Number one, notice as we look at these three things, notice that it is sinners who are justified by God. God is not looking for saints. Amen. In sanctification, you grow to be who God wants you to be. But sinners are the ones justified by God. Did you see what kind of people Paul was writing about in 1 Corinthians 6, 9, and 10? look back at some of that stuff. He said, you're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived, neither fornicators nor idolaters. That's people who worship idols. Nor adulterers. That's people who play around. Supposed to be married and they're playing around. Nor effeminate. That's men who act like women. Women who act like men. Nor abusers of themselves with mankind. In other words, to take a God's authority and lay it on themselves. Nor thieves. That's taking somebody else's stuff. Nor covetous. That's wanting somebody else's stuff or life. Nor drunkards. That's somebody who's abusing themselves with strong drink. Nor revilers. Those are people who fight and are part of violence. Nor extortioners. Those people who extort and take other people's belongings shall inherit the kingdom of God. Look at verse 11 then one more time. He says, and such were some of you, but you're washed, you're sanctified, and you're justified. Look at that last piece. He says, how am I justified? In the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. These are the very people that Paul said were now just and right through faith. He said, but you're washed. Who washed you? God washed you. But you're sanctified. Who sanctified you? God sanctified you. But you were justified. Who justified you? God justified you. These were the very people, Paul said, who were now just and right through faith. Look at the second thing about justification. This points us to another characteristic of this justification thing. Justification is by faith. Justification is by faith. Paul compared justification by works and justification by faith. You cannot do this on your own standard. You can't make your own standard. That's just like making up your own test, then taking your own test, and then you scoring your own test. It doesn't work that way. We are justified. We're made right before God based on the condition of our faith in Him, not by anything we do. When Martin Luther was climbing the sacred stairs in the Roman church, in church history, amen, some of you in the seminary work, amen, you study about Martin Luther and history of church, amen, part of their tradition was that they would climb the sacred stair. They were to kiss each step as they went up the stairway. And as he was kissing every step that was required by the priest, but when he remembered what Paul wrote in Scripture at Romans 1 and 7, in Romans 1 and 7, Paul wrote, the just shall live by faith. So Martin Luther stood up and walked back down those stairs saying, the just shall live by faith. That got him in a lot of trouble. That became the battle cry of what we know today as the Reformation. Brothers and sisters, we're here because of the Reformation. Why? Because justification is by faith. I said faith. A lot of people say they don't have that kind of faith. Yes, you do. We exercise faith all the time. We go to a doctor that we do not know. Did you hear what I said? We will go into a room they point us to and take off our clothes. Did you hear what I said? Somebody that we come in that we don't know can examine us. We don't know them. We trust what they got on the wall. We have done no research. We don't know that if it's theirs or somebody else's. Then they will write some words on a piece of paper that we cannot read. We will take it to somebody else that we do not know. They will give us something in a bottle that we don't know what it is. We will go home, take it, and then go to bed, and we say we have no faith. Come on. You know, it baffles my mind. There are people who say, well, I can't take this vaccination that's going on. Amen, because I don't know anything about it. God told me that the other day. I said, wait a minute, brother, wasn't you the one that just had surgery? He said, yeah. I said, then, sir, didn't they put you out? He said, yeah. I said, you don't know what they did to you. You know, we have some crazy arguments and things. We say things that we have not a clue in our mind what it's about. Don't tell me you have no faith. Just tell me you don't want to exercise it with God. Here's the third thing. Justification by faith is based on Christ's work for us. His work for us. I said Christ's work for us. Notice how we are washed. Notice how we are sanctified and justified in the name of the Lord Jesus, and by the Spirit of our God. That's what verse 11 says. Look at the bottom of that verse. We're washed, we're sanctified, and we're justified in the name of the Lord Jesus, not in my name, but by the Spirit of our God. A preacher tried to explain to a guy that was a minor in Virginia that salvation is a free gift of God, that he didn't need to buy it. It had already been purchased. But the minor, he couldn't understand. He's a simple guy. He just couldn't understand how something so valuable could be free. He couldn't understand that it didn't cost him anything. And so he brushed out the preacher. So one day the preacher went to work with him in the mines. They began to go down into the mine. They prepared to go down. And down in the mine, it was several hundred feet. And they were using a company elevator. So the preacher turned to the miner and he says that we got to go into the mine and work. He says, I'm going in this by this elevator. He said, yeah, we're going to go by the elevator. Preacher said, well, how much will this cost me? How much is this ride in this elevator going to cost me? The miner said, it's not going to cost you anything. Preacher then said, well, that's too cheap. I don't want to ride on anything that costs nothing. Then the miner said, cheap? Have you lost your mind? Do you know that this elevator costs $250,000? The company paid that much for this elevator just so that we would be safe. Then the preacher said, oh, so I understand. It cost me nothing, but it did cost somebody else a whole lot. Then the miner's eyes opened real wide, and he said, now I understand. Brothers and sisters, this is the way that salvation is for us. It cost us nothing, but it cost Jesus a whole lot. It cost Christ all that he had. So the next time you think that you don't need to be bothered with church, or you don't need to worry about living right, or that it doesn't take all of that, just remember your salvation is not cheap. It cost Jesus all that he had. Don't treat your salvation like it costs nothing. Brothers and sisters, this is what it means to be saved. Salvation is about being forgiven. It's about being sanctified and, yes, even justified. And it's all different aspects of the same act of salvation. Brother, you don't have to be the local dope head or act like the town drunk. Sister, you don't have to be anybody's whore. When you got saved, God smiled on you. And Jesus was saying, you're worth it. When he came down through 42 generations, he was saying, you're worth it. When he came into this mean, cruel world, he was saying, you're worth it. When he allowed them to arrest him in the Garden of Gethsemane, he was saying, you're worth it. When they nailed his hands, spiked his feet, hoisted him high, dropped him low, put a crown of thorns on his head, and then from the sixth to the ninth hour, he hung his head and died. He was saying, you are worth it. But more than that, when he stayed in the grave for 3 days and three nights, and then rose with all power in heaven and earth in his hand, he was saying, you are worth it. That, my brothers and sisters, means to be saved. That's what it means to be saved. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. So why wouldn't I worship a God like that? Why wouldn't I live my life to honor him? Why wouldn't I die on this side so that I can live on that side? The God we serve is a jealous God. Any husband would be jealous if another man came to his house to take his wife out for a date. I wish I had a witness. But we serve a jealous God. You say that you love the Lord, but you won't even read his love letter to you. You say that you love the Lord, but you won't even honor him. Something's wrong with that picture. I stop by to tell you that there are things that salvation means. The world is watching. People are dying and on their way to hell. God has left us here as the children of God. We were messed up. No God on our side. We were adulterers. Effeminate. We were idolaters. We were missing things that God wanted us to have. But now I'm washed. Now I'm sanctified. Now I'm justified so that I can be of service, so that I can be forgiven, but also so I can be God wants me to be justified and saved for his service. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. Have a wonderful Sunday.
What a powerful word this morning. I'm excited because what does it mean to be saved? I want to thank our pastor once again for a powerful word from the Word of God. Paul writes in that Corinthians to the Corinthians, and pastor laid it out. You might be one in that category of men and illustrations that he shared with us today. You might need a name change. You might be hitching your vehicle, parking your vehicle where you don't need to park it no more. What does it mean to be saved? What does it mean is that you have to acknowledge the fact that I am lost. I've been traveling the wrong way. We see weekly, we see on our local news and national news, we see people, for whatever reasons, ends up headed the wrong way. And that's life. Outside of Christ, you're headed the wrong way. Outside of the Lord, you're headed the wrong way. It's invitation time. And that invitation is always, we give, offer the invitation. We can't give it. We offer the invitation because we learn in God's word in Revelation 3 and 20 says, I stand at the door and knock. If any man, that tells me that the knob's on the inside of your heart. You can make a decision today. You can continue to go in the wrong way. And it's very easy to happen because if you're in a unfamiliar city and you're in an area and they done changed the freeways and you're not really sure and you think you're going the right direction, but you can find yourself headed the wrong way. But I'm so thankful that Jesus have those warning signs. I am the way. He said, I am the truth and I am the life. He said, any man come unto me. And that's what this invitation is all about. I always like to ask this question. Do you know him? You can know him today. We learn in our sermon today through our pastor, the word of God, that as Paul wrote to the Corinthians, says, some of you would like this. Oh, in witnessing and sharing with men and women over the years, I've had those that tell me, say, well, I got time. Just the other day in the city of Chicago, we see a 13-year-old, and we always ask, say, what is a 13-year-old doing out at 2:30 in the morning? But we live in a sin-sick world. We live in a dark world. That's here or there, but that 13-year-old is, he's gone. And there are those that we see across the waters that a 99-year-old closed his eyes the other day and he made that transition. Somebody said, well, what's the difference in 13 and 99? Only God knows your time because he tells us in Psalms 90 to number your days. What am I telling you? It's getting late in the evening and the sun's going down. The urgency is, do you know Jesus? The urgency is, if you died today, where would you spend eternity? Make up your mind today. Those that are viewing by live screen, you're saying, well, Brother Hunter, you know, you every Sunday, Pastor Hall or Reverend Fields or Reverend Johnson or Reverend Wheatfall, you give us that invitation. What steps do I need to make? First, acknowledge the fact that I'm going the wrong way. And go back and study that scripture that Pastor taught us today. And when Paul pleaded with him, he said, now listen, don't be walking around with your head up in the air. Because some of you was just like that. You was lost and headed to hell. Oh, when I was a kid growing up, I used to hear those elders. And when I was in the church, running around the church, just like the little kid that we christened today. I used to hear those elders would say something to the effect, and they'd start rocking with it and say, getting late in the evening, the sun's going down. Oh, when I was a kid, I had no nuke. But I know now, when I leave home, that's not guaranteed that I'm going to walk back in those doors. But I could guarantee one thing. I will spend eternity with our Savior, and his name is Jesus, and I want to see you there. I want you to be there with me. If you're trying to clean up your life, you can't do it. It's impossible. Because Paul, once again, writes and said, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And another place in the scripture said, and all our righteousness is like filthy rags. Somebody said, well, what do I have to do? Just like those illustrations that Pastor gave us, those three different individuals, you have to make up your mind that I don't want to live like this anymore. Jesus said it so plainly. He said, I'd rather you with hot or cold, because by being lukewarm, I'm going to spew you out of the mouth. It might be somebody viewing today that's been attending church and name is on a roll at someone's church, but have never been born again and never accepted Jesus as the Lord and Savior. It's not about works. It's not about how good you are. Because that's why he went to Calvary, because at the foot of the cross, it is level ground. He said, come as you are. Make up your mind today. It is ours to invite you to accept Jesus. Now, it might be somebody viewing with us today that don't have a church home, and you've been, because of the epidemic and because of things that's been happening, you need to unite with a church. And you're not united with anyone, please call us. If you call and there are ones there at the answer to the phone at the time, just leave a message. And somebody will call you back, because we want to invite you into the family of God. And if you don't have a church home, you're welcome to unite with us and be on this journey to heaven, lifting and walking on the King's highway. That's our invitation. May God bless you and keep you is our desire.
Stay engaged, be active, move from the sideline and work in God's kingdom. Learn how you can get involved.
The Mother's Board is updating its roster. For our women members 80 years old and wiser, contact the church office to leave your name and a good phone number. A board representative will contact you with further details. Mother's Day is almost here. Help us prepare. Members may send in one clear photograph of their mother in honor of her special day. Email your best picture to info@bethany1925.com by May 1st. Then join us on Mother's Day for a special tribute during worship service. Dial in every Tuesday at 6 p.m. to the Bethany Prayer Line. Pray for one another, submit prayer requests, and rejoice in praise reports. From a touch-tone phone, call 720-650-3030 and enter access code 77028. You can now build your own personal collection of your favorite Sunday morning sermons. CD recordings are available $5 purchase through the contact information provided on your screen. For questions, contact our church office at 713-633-4831. Don't forget, the process for submitting announcements and requesting media services has not changed. All requests must go to the communications team at info@bethany1925.com. This is the same process we follow for recognition of milestone birthdays and wedding anniversaries for 4th Sundays.
The
that blood is that shed blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That blood, he shed it for you and he shed it for me. Over 2,000 years ago, on that old rugged cross, on that hill called Calvary, that blood. And so many times, and as believers, and we get lackadaisy, but somebody's sacrifice that me and you might have life. And his name is Jesus. He shed his blood. And sometimes, even myself, I run through that, but you can't run through that. Somebody sacrifice. I'm reminded in the book of Revelation when John was on the Isle of Patmos and he had that vision and he was showed some things, and he said they covered the heavens and they covered the earth and they covered beneath the earth, and there was nobody to open the book. The scripture says John was saddened. I'm like, Pastor Hall, now check me out. It's in the word. And he said, when he hit his knees and he began to had a sadness to come over, the angels told him, he said, God has prepared the Lamb to open the book of life. And that's that blood that we were singing about. And he prepared it on Calvary. But before he went to Calvary, he had the last meal, the last supper as me and you know it, in that upper room with his disciples. And that was, at first it was a joyous occasion because it was time of the Passover and they were gathering together. And I like the way Pastor said that, teaches over the years, he said it was a celebration because it was the Passover. And we know the history of the Passover, and when the deaf angel passed by the Jews, because on their post of the lamppost of their house there, the blood was sprinkled or painted there, and that deaf angel passed them by. And every year after that, the Jews would have that supper, the Passover supper. But this time the Passover supper was different. There was a solemnness about this Passover because Jesus dropped a bombshell on them. He began to share with them, this is going to be the last time I eat with you on this side. I'm like, Pastor, you get this when you get home. They didn't understand that. It was a ritual. It was a tradition. And he began to say, I won't eat and I won't break bread with you no more until I come back. And then he began to say, in the scripture, he said, one of you will betray me. And then they began to get serious among themselves. They began to say, who might that be? And as they were murmuring among themselves, and as they began to ask the question, who might it be? The scripture tells us that John, but before John leaned on Jesus' chest, Peter asked him, he said, he nudged John, he said, would you ask him to see who might it be? And John leaned on Jesus' chest and began to ask him, who would betray him? And he said, the one that dippeth in the dip with me, he would be the one that betray me. The scripture tells us that it was Judas that dipped into the dip with Jesus. Jesus looked in his eyes. And I thank God once again for our pastor. He has taught us over the years. He said, Judas had an opportunity to change his mind. And the Lord looked into his eyes and in his face and said, do what you must do and do it quickly. And then as Judas left the building, some thought he was going to buy some more or give money to the poor. But we know that he had betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of gold. And then when Judas left the room, the scripture said, and it was night. And that's when we learned that the institution of the Lord's Supper was introduced. And at this time, as we prepare for the Lord's Supper, we're going to come. I have Deacon Ladin and Deacon Howard that's going to share with me. Deacon Ladin will be praying for the bread, and Deacon Howard will be praying for the fruit of the vine that represents the blood of Jesus as we prepare. Deacon Ladin, blessing for the bread.
Heavenly Father, we want to thank you today in your darling Son, Jesus' name, as we prepare to partake in the body of Christ. And you say it as often as we do this, we do it in remembrance of you. And today we're remembering the sacrifices you made on that hill called Calvary. Amen.
Amen. Deacon Howard.
Oh, Father in heaven, we come in this hour. Thank you, O God, for the fruit of the vine that represent the blood that you shed on Calvary. O God, you said often we do this. We do it in the remembrance of you. Thank you. For this we ask in our Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, my brother. Those are viewing with us on live screen, this wafer represents the body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us break it and eat it all. The fruit of the vine that represents the shed blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us drink it all. As it comes to the conclusion of another one of our live screen services, and we thank God for the christening of that young child this morning. That's a blessing within itself. The baby being brought back to the house of God to dedicate that child to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now we have those families looking this way by faith. We have bereaved families that have experienced death in their families. We want to lift those families up. We have families that are having procedures this week that's going in for overnight, and some just in and out procedures. But as we talk, and we know nothing is simple, but we're going to ask God's favor, we're going to ask God's healing. And saints, I'm pleading with you, let us continue to lift our youth up. We see the unrest in America, in our country. We see the breakdown in our families, in our community. But our hope is in Jesus. And if we would just call on him, Psalms 121 say, look to the hills which cometh our help. All our help comes from the Lord. So let us pray. Father God, we thank you once again for a powerful message, Father God. Thank you for using the vessel, the angel of this house, Dr. Hall. Continue to bless him mightily, Father God. Lord, I thank you for his wife and his family. Strengthen that household, Father God. Oh, Lord, we know, like all household, we're under attack. But that's okay, Father, because you told us in your word, Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30, you said, come unto me, all ye heavy laden, And Lord, we're going to bring our burdens to you. Now, Lord, strengthen our leadership here. Lord, we thank you for the trustees. We thank you for our deacons that govern this body, Father God. And Lord, I lift the prayer team up, Father God, faithfully every Tuesday night at 6 p.m., Father God. The prayer warriors, the prayer team, is manning the phone, Father God, lifting men and women up in prayer. And I thank you, Father God. Oh, God, we owe it all to you, Lord. We give you the glory, honor, and praise. And, Lord, if by chance, if there's somebody that don't know you in the partners of your pardon, Father God, we pray that they come into the knowledge of you and come running and asking or calling the lines and asking somebody, what must I do to be saved? And we give you the glory, and we give you the honor, and we give you your praise. Father, it'll be selfish on my part, but we pray for every man and woman, every believer, Father God. We pray for every God-fearing churches that's open in your name. Oh, God, we need you, and we need you now. Oh, Lord, I thank you for our president. I thank you for a man that, to me, is trying to make a difference, Father God. I pray for all our government, Father God. And we just thank you for America. We want to make a difference, Father God. And Lord, I learned in your word, Father God, if we lift you up, you do the drawing. Now, Lord, may the grace of our Lord and Savior rest, rule, and abide in each and every one of us. Henceforth and forevermore, let the body of believers say amen and thank God. Go in peace, and may God bless you and keep you is our prayer.
Thank you for being with us, brothers and sisters. What a wonderful time of live stream worship. We're getting good at this. We thank the Lord for you. We thank the Lord for all that has been able to be accomplished. Our production team, all of those good people are doing a wonderful thing, making sure that we can continue to bring worship this live stream way to you. Thank you for being with us. May the Lord bless you. If you have not made a decision for Christ, we implore you to make a decision for Jesus Christ. We'll be glad to walk alongside of you. You can make contact with us, 713-633-4831, and we'll be glad to do what we can during this time of live stream worship to make sure that your walk with the Lord is not impaired. Remember, all things work together for the good of those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. God bless you. Have a good Sunday.